श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। अ वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू एट अनदर सेशन ऑफ वीकेंड विद विजडम। लेट मी बिगिन विद अ स्मॉल प्रेयर। सदा शिवा समारंभाम शंकराचार्य मध्यमाम अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंताम वंदे गुरु परंपराम ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्ति वेद विभागिने व्योमवत् व्याप्त देहाय श्री दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। भारती करुणा पात्रं भारती पदभूषणं भारती पदमारूढं भारती तीर्थमाश्रये विद्या विनय संपन्नं वीतरागं विवेकिनं वंदे वेदांत तत्त्वज्ञं विदुशेखर भारतीं। टुडे वी हैव ए वेरी स्पेशल गेस्ट Swami Swatmananda ji joining us all the way from Mumbai. He will be speaking on a very important topic of Shravanam to Samadhi, a kind of core of Vedanta sadhana. And before I open the floor to him, a brief introduction to Swami ji. Swami Swatmananda ji is one of the most dynamic leaders of Chinmaya Mission. He is currently posted in Chinmaya Mission South Mumbai, and he completed his Vedanta course from Powai between 1998 and 2000 after his graduation in Commerce and Software Engineering. And since then, he has been serving Chinmaya Mission Mumbai, and he has been giving talks and he is teaching Vedanta through Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads and other texts of Vedanta as well as Bhakti. Through camps, meditation, retreats, interactive sessions and discussions, especially with youths. He has also taken a youth empowerment program, which is a value-based leadership program for youth who want to serve the nation and culture, wherein the youngsters are trained for around 3 months and then they are sent to serve the country for 9 months. And there is a creative side to Swamiji as well. He has written two, three theatrical performances. He has written and directed them. One is Adrishya, Quest for the Unseen, which is based on Saraswati civilization. And this was directed in 2009. And there was another one which is titled as Just Like That. It's a play based on Bhagavad Gita in the life of Anand family. And how they discover harmony by applying the principles of Gita. So Swamiji has very interesting dimensions. I have been interacting with him off and on for the last few months, and I have personally been very inspired by him, his dynamism, and he's very active and also rooted in philosophy. So thank you very much, Swamiji, for taking time and agreeing to do this session.
Hari Om. Thank you, Nitinji and Advaita Academy, for this wonderful opportunity. Weekend with Wisdom, and specifically on Advaita Vedanta. So nice to reflect on these sadhanas from Shravanam to Samadhi. Om सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां श्रुति स्मृति पुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पाद शंकरं लोकशंकरं शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्म विद्वरम्। हरि ओम एंड सैल्यूटेशंस टू वन एंड ऑल। अ पर्सन वंस वेंट टू द ग्रेट मास्टर, स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर, एंड सेड, हाउ कैन आई बिकम अ ग्रेट ह्यूमन बीइंग? एंड द स्पिरिचुअल मास्टर रिप्लाइड, that you are human being itself is a great blessing. Recognize that. What is the uniqueness of this human birth? we have been blessed with a sukshma buddhi, which can do sukshma vivek. Sthula vivek, every other jiva, every other being also can do. What to eat, what not to eat, where to go, where not to go, who is a friend, who is enemy. Other jivas also do that. But human being is capable of much more than that. The subtler forms of vivek, sukha dukha vivek, where is real happiness and what is the source of sorrow? Shreyas prayas vivek, what is good and what is pleasant? Nitya anitya vivek, what is temporary, what is permanent? Atma anatma vivek, what is the self, what is the not self? Sadhana sadhya vivek, what is the means, what is the goal? Different types of vivek this human being is capable of. And so when we ask ourselves as a human being, what is it that we can do to make the best of our human life? The Upanishads very clearly say, Atma va are drashtavyaha. That Atma is to be realized. Today we have mixed up Atma and Anatma. What is the Atma we have forgotten? What is the Anatma, which is this body, mind, intellect? We are thinking of that as the Atma. The word Atma means I, Aham. That Aham has become mixed up, confused with what is not Aham. So this body, mind, intellect is not me, but I am thinking of myself as the Jiva, as this body, mind, intellect. So Vedant says, no, no, no. Do this Atma Anatma Vivek, and through that come to realize who you are truly. Ramana Maharshi championed this inquiry, who am I inquiry. Upanishads tell us to ask, who are we actually? Koham. Bhagavan Ramana said in four words, he summarized in four words, Koham, ask, who am I? Naturally, the answer will be Deham. I am this body, I am this mind, I am this intellect, I am happy, I am sad, I am tall, I am dark, I am young, I am handsome, I am successful, I am believer, I am an atheist. All connected to the body, mind, intellect. Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi says, no, no, you are not that. Naham. Reject that. Koham, Deham, Naham. Then who am I? Soham. I am that pure consciousness. To realize that pure consciousness is the main purpose of human birth, and this is possible specifically in this human birth because we have this ability to think and do subtle vivek and then live by that. So when the Upanishad says Atma va are drashtavyaha, the goal of life, the goal of, in fact, all evolution is to know who am I. Drashtavya does not mean to see as an object here. Drashtavya means to experience that who is this Atma? That Atma is infinite consciousness. Atma va are drashtavya. Now, how to know? How to experience that Atma? So, the Upanishad gives the direct means for it. Shrotavya, mantavya, nididhyasitavya. Through Shravan, Manan and Nididhyasan, one will know this truth. In fact, not even all the three are required if the mind is pure. The Siddhanta in Vedanta is Shravanam Matrena Jnanam Bhavati. Just by listening to the truth from the teacher, from the realized master, one will know the truth. The Uttam Adhikari realizes instantly. Nachiketa is one example of that. Yamraj tried to tempt him with so many different types of earthly pleasures, heavenly pleasures, but he rejected it all. And he says, keep all this dance and music with you, tavaiva vaha tava nritya gite. Just give me the knowledge of the self. The third boon he asked, that knowledge of the self. And when Bhagavan gave that knowledge, he realized instant. He didn't have to go back, reflect and contemplate. But those Uttam Adhikaris are very few. So the Siddhant in Vedanta is Shravanam Matrena Jnanam Bhavati, by listening to the Mahavakya from the teacher, Acharya Mukha Shravanam Kuryat. Listen to it from this teacher who is Shrotriya Brahmanishtha, who is well established in the Supreme Truth and who is knowledgeable about the scriptures. From such a person, when we listen to the truth, if we are ready, realization will be instant. But if our mind is not yet prepared, then we have to do other two sadhanas also. Mananam, then Nididhyasana, that will lead to Savikalpa Samadhi, Nirvikalpa Samadhi, Sahaj Samadhi. So the direct means of realization of the self is this, Shravanam to Samadhi. Now, those of us who know, we have studied Vedanta, we are familiar with the path of Vedanta. So to come to even Shravanam, to listen to a teacher, one must have certain preparations. So Vedanta says, three preparations are very important. First is Chitta Shuddhi should happen, where our mind has become free from the six impurities. Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, Mada, Matsarya. Selfishness, anger, greed, Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Moha, delusion, Mada, intoxication, Matsarya, jealousy. How will I become free from these six? The first one, Kama, is the cause for the other five. When Kama is fulfilled, it gives rise to Lobha, Moha, and Mada. When Kama is not fulfilled, it gives rise to Krodha and Matsarya. So this Kama must be conquered. Kama can be conquered when we transform it into Nishkama. So Vedanta Shastra says that first step is the practice of Karma Yoga. Doing our duties, dedicating it to the Supreme Lord, doing it with the bhav that I am only an instrument, I am not the karta. When a person lives one's life that way, the mind becomes purified. Chitta Shuddhi it is called. Then the person must do the second step. The upasana one must do for Chitta Ekagrata. To cultivate single pointedness of the mind, various upasanas are given. It may be upasanas connecting to certain aspects of nature. Like in the Upanishads, we have the Prashna Upanishad speaks about Surya Upasana. You know, the Keno Upanishad gives about thunder and lightning. Different types of upasanas are there. Taittiriya Upanishad gives the Panchakosha Upasana. The example of a bird is given there. So different upasanas are given. In today's context, we may even have Ishta Devata's Upasana. Choosing one specific form of the Lord, building a relationship with that form, and then channelizing all emotions and thoughts towards that one form of the Lord. Like Ramakrishna had the bhav that I am a child and the Lord Bhagwan is my mother, as Mother Kali. Hanumanji has a bhav of a sevak towards the Lord. Sudama has the bhav of a friend. Mirabai has the bhav of a beloved. So through one form, one relationship, one develops the single pointedness. So Chitta Shuddhi and Chitta Ekagrata when we have, then there will be Jignyasa in the mind. One will want to know, who am I? That Jignyasa, when it is there, one goes to a teacher, Guru Upasakti. The scriptures are very clear that this knowledge can be gained only from a teacher. It cannot be gained from any number of books or videos or talks or recordings. One person went to Gurudev Swami Chinmayanandji and asked, youngster, Swamiji, so many books are available, cassettes are there, videos are there, why do I need a guru? And Gurudev answered very humorously. He said, go and ask this question to the book. books cannot answer, and book does not know. Book can give some information, no doubt, and Shastra we do study, but a teacher is required. Acharyavan Purusho Veda, Upanishad is very clear. The person who has an Acharya, that person will know the truth. Because this knowledge is not from the book. It is not in the words. It is an intuitive understanding that arises that my nature is pure consciousness. It is not a verbal knowledge, informative knowledge. It does not pass from the lips of the teacher to the ears of the student. It goes from the heart of the teacher to the heart of the student. When they are tuned, then this knowledge transfer happens. And of course, I'm saying transfer, it does not mean that the Shishya does not have that knowledge. As the consciousness, we are Jnana Swarup already. But today we have forgotten, so we don't know. And hence a teacher is required to help us remove these obstructions to knowledge. So one has to approach the teacher. All these are the preparatory means. Karma Yoga, Upasana, Guru Upasati. And even when we go to the Guru, Vedanta says fourfold qualifications if one has, then one will benefit maximum. Vivek, discrimination between real and unreal. Vairagya, the absence of hankering of pleasure here and hereafter. Shatka Sampatti, mind control, sense control, forbearance, withdrawal, faith, absorption. These are Shatka Sampattis. And Samadhan Mumukshutvam. Fourth quality is Mumukshutvam. Intense desire for liberation. If one has gone to the teacher, having cultivated these fourfold qualifications, one will benefit maximum, one will realize also very quickly. Sometimes if that has not happened, one goes to the teacher and in the company of the teacher, one stays, one associates and slowly develops these qualities. All this is the preparatory means. With such a mind which is prepared, one has to listen to the teacher, Shravanam. So the direct means of realization is this Jnana Sadhana, which is Shravanam, Mananam, Nididhyasanam, which of course leads to Samadhi. So we are exploring this topic today, Shravanam to Samadhi. So what is the meaning of Shravanam? Shravanam literally means Shru, means to hear. Shruti, also word comes from the root Shru, means to hear. So it is not just hearing, it is listening. Our scriptures give a lot of importance to listening. In fact, all knowledge we gain only by listening. There is no knowledge which we gain without listening. No, Swami, we read books also. How did we know the sound of those words? Somebody told us this is A, this is B, this is A, this is A, this is Ka, this is Kha, this is Ta, this is Tha. We heard. Then the alphabets put together the words, and then the sound, then the meaning. All that we have heard. So no knowledge is possible without listening. One has to gain the knowledge. Main sadhana for gaining knowledge even in the world is listening first. If there are some challenges in listening, then of course then the other senses become active and one can gain knowledge. That's a different matter. But we are talking about in general. So listening is a very, very important step. In fact, all the preparations are to listen carefully. That's why Bhagavan gave us 2 ears and 1 mouth. So that we listen more and speak less. But we do exact opposite. We talk much more and listen very less. Even when somebody is talking, we are thinking what next to talk and to respond to them. So listening is very, very crucial. In fact, our Vedas are called Shruti. They are born from they are the expression of the oral tradition. When the students were listening to the teacher and this knowledge is passed on from one generation to the other, And these mantras also were revealed by the Lord to the great rishis whose minds were quiet, purified. So they are called Shruti. They heard in their meditation as it is. They have not had an intuitive insight and then written it down in their language. The mantras revealed as it is to them, which they have just compiled. And Vedavyasji brought it out in the form of books. So, listening is a very, very crucial aspect. And when we say listening, in the world also today, a lot of problems happen because one doesn't listen carefully. Maximum, one of the highest paid professions in the world today is of a psychiatrist or a shrink, what they call, who is just listening because people are not available to listen to each other. Listening is hearing with complete intellectual alertness and awareness. It's not just sound falling on the ears. It is listening with full attention, alertness, awareness. In fact, in Tulsi Ramayan, there's a portion in Aranyakand where Lakshmanji is asking various questions to Bhagwan Ram about Jnana, about Vairagya, about Maya, about Bhakti. Before Bhagwan replies, he tells Lakshmanji, Sunahu tat man mati chitlai. He says, bring all the three together and listen with alertness. What? Man, emotions. Mati is our intellect. Chit is memory. And our mind generally gets distracted by these three in listening. Some emotional disturbance will be there. Somebody said something which either has excited me or made me sad or made me angry, and my mind is disturbed. So either emotions trouble us or our own intellectual concepts and knowledge we have had earlier, we are not able to put that aside and listen with fresh mind. Already we are listening with a lot of conditionings. So Bhagwan says, you put aside the old conditionings, put aside the emotional turbulence and mati. Don't get caught in memory. Some enjoyment of the past that will create further desire for future enjoyment. So the mind gets deviated. It's not in the present. It goes into past or future. So many barriers. Today they call it as barriers in listening. External barriers, internal barriers. External barriers can be there are different sounds, there are different disturbances, people around, beings around, or you know, cosmic forces, there is some rain, cyclone, different ways in which one's hearing, one's listening can be disturbed. But more than the external barriers are the internal barriers. Our own attachments, aversions, raga, dvesha. Our own emotions, our past conditionings, our prejudices about people. So even if somebody is giving a valid input, if I have a prejudiced opinion about that person, I will not accept that input. Why? Because I think that that person is wrong or that person's opinion should not be taken at all. It may be a very valid input, but one doesn't listen. Now, listening is to put aside all these filters and listen carefully. Before I go into, see, Vedant gives the technical definition of listening. So it's not just this much. Vedant goes one step ahead that how should one listen to the Upanishads and the Mahavakyas. There's a beautiful definition Vedant gives. And we should also remember one fact that this listening is with the same mind and attitude that we have, we are going to listen to Vedant also. So we should not separate this saying, okay, this is meant for my other aspects of life, my relationship, work, etc. And for Vedant, something else. No, no. How much I am able to listen, with what mindset I am able to listen, with how much attention I am able to listen, that will impact even my Vedantic study and understanding. So what does Vedant say about Shravanam? So in Vedant Sa, this beautiful definition which is given here, Shravanam Nama षड विधलिंगैः अशेष वेदांतानां अद्वितीय वस्तुनि तात्पर्य अवधारणम्. दिस इज द टेक्निकल डेफिनेशन ऑफ वेदांत ऑफ श्रवणम इन वेदांत. इन वेदांत सार स्वामी सदानंद जी हैज गिवन दिस ब्यूटिफुल डेफिनेशन दैट व्हाट इज श्रवणम. षड विधलिंगैः देयर आर सिक्स साइंस, आई मीन सिक्स साइंस, लिंगम मीन्स साइन. देयर आर सिक्स पैरामीटर्स which one should apply to the Upanishads or to the Gita or whichever Shastra one is studying, Shadvidhalingaihi, and what should be done with those six, Ashesha Vedantanam, of the entire Vedantic literature, what should one determine, Advitiya Vastuni, one should determine the essence, which is non-duality. And the determining of the essence is called Shravanam, Tatparyavadharanam. So in short, if one has to say Shravanam nama Tatparyavadharanam, to determine what is the essence of the Veda is called listening. And to help us to determine that essence, the six parameters have to be applied. So it is not just listening with attention, alertness, but it is to determine this is the essence of the Veda. Or let us say, if we simplify it, suppose we are studying the Bhagavad Gita. Now somebody may say, okay, I have studied the Bhagavad Gita. Now what is the essence of Bhagavad Gita? So one person says the essence of the Gita is to do the duty. Another person says the essence of the Gita is surrender to God. Somebody says the essence of the Gita is that fight for dharma, you know, dedicate yourself to the higher cause of dharma. Each one can say according to their understanding, what they have grasped, what is applicable in their life. But Gita is not a dharma shastra alone. It is actually a moksha shastra. So if we apply these six parameters to the Gita, we will find that the essence of the Gita is Brahma Vidya. And the knowledge of that Brahman is what Bhagavan wanted to give through the Gita to Arjun and destroy his root cause of sorrow, which is ignorance. So if ignorance has to go, knowledge has to arise. How will knowledge arise? The Jnana Sadhana is this, Shravanam Mananam Nididhyasana. So you can apply this Shadvidhalinga to the Gita also. Today we will take up for the Upanishad. Because the essence of Veda is the Upanishad, and in the Upanishad, the Mahavakya, the most famous Mahavakya is Tattvamasi. And that Tattvamasi comes in Chandogya Upanishad. So how to determine the essence now? When one is listening, one should apply these six parameters. So what are these six parameters now? So the six parameters are Lingani to Upakrama. First is Upakrama. What is said in the beginning? Second is Upasamhara, what is said at the end. Upakrama, Upasamhara, Abhyasa, what is repeated. Apurvata, what is unique specifically to this particular scripture. Apurvata. Phala, what is the result? If I study this, determine the essence, what will be the result that I will get? And Apurvata Phalam is one. Then Arthavada is praise. What is being praised? What is glorified? And last is Arthavada Utpatti Akhyani and the demonstration. What is practically also being demonstrated. If these six we apply, then we will determine what is the essence. You can apply this to any talk, you can apply to any book, any shastra, scripture, anything. The six parameters are applicable to determine what is the essence. Otherwise, many times we listen to the whole talk. You know, one man went home after listening to the teacher. and the wife asked him, what was the main topic of the talk? 1.5 hours you spent there. What was the main topic of the talk? And the person replied, the speaker didn't tell that only. What listening has that person done? Speaker didn't tell the topic means he did not determine what is the essence of the whole talk. Then the listening has not happened properly. So these six aspects one should determine. Now we will go into the Chandogya Upanishad to understand how Advaita Vedanta or the nature of the self is the main topic of the Upanishad. Because many people, now somebody says, why should I determine this essence? Because see, what happens is, a lot of times, one does not determine what is the essence. Like many people think, there's a shloka, there's a mantra, Amnayasya Kriyarthatvat. If there is a mantra in the Veda, it is prompting us to do some karma. It's from Mimamsa. So when we do certain karma, then we will get punya, we will go to heaven. If there are mantras which are not action oriented, which will not tell me to do something, then they are only meant for chanting. So a lot of people think that Upanishads are only for chanting, and with the chanting I will get punya, and with that punya I will go to heaven. They don't understand that beyond chanting, beyond punya, there is the higher nature of the reality, which is our true self, which is beyond punya and papa. So for them, Upanishad mantra is meant only for chanting. For somebody else, Upanishad mantra is meant for propagating a certain philosophy, which is Dvaita. So Tattvamasi, they will split as Tasyatvamasi. You belong to God. Either you are a servant of God or you are a part of God. Vishishta Dvaita and Dvaita. How to know that the essential nature of this Upanishadic teaching is Advitiya Vastu, because that's the definition in the Shravanam also. Advitiya Vastuni Tatparya Avadharanam. One should determine that the essence is Advaita. The knowledge of the essential oneness of the Jiva and Ishvara. And Mahavakya is meant for that. So many Mahavakyas which are there, four are the main ones. Prajnanam Brahma, Ayamatma Brahma, Tattvamasi, Aham Brahmasmi. One from each Veda. So this Mahavakya I have to listen from the teacher and determine the essence of that Mahavakya. That Mahavakya is not telling me that I belong to God or I am a part of God. Mahavakya is saying you are essentially divine, you are not this body, mind, intellect. Now how to come to that conclusion? So these six parameters, they will help very clearly. So now let us see each one. So we are taking the sixth chapter of Chandogya Upanishad as the base to analyze. Because Tattvamasi is the most famous Mahavakya. Now here, first is what is said in the beginning, what is said at the end. First and second parameters are these. So, Ekameva Advitiyam is said in the beginning, Iti Adav, and Aitadatma Idagam Sarvam, Iti Antecha Pratipadanam. So that chapter is very clearly saying there is one absolute Brahman, which is the truth. Ekameva Advitiyam is non-dual absolute Brahman. And what is that? Aitadatmagam Idagam Sarvam. That Brahman is this Atma which is appearing as all this. So Upasamhara, Upakrama and Upasamhara. What is said in the beginning, what is said in the end is the emphasis is on Advaita Vedanta, is on Advaita, the non-dual truth. Then, what is again and again repeated? So, that is the Abhyasa. So, Pauna Punyena Pratipadanam Abhyasaha. Again and again, what is repeated? So, in that Chandogya Upanishad, different experiments are done and 9 times the teacher repeats Tattvamasi Shweta Keto, Tattvamasi Shweta Keto, that thou art. So what is repeated also is this, that there is one Supreme Brahman. Tattvamasiti navakritvaha pratipadanam. 9 times he repeats. Not 1, 2 times, 3 times. 9 times. A different experiment. A beautiful chapter that is in Chandogya. Different experiments that teacher is doing with Shvetaketu. And he is a father of Shvetaketu himself, Uddala Krishi. And through that, he has emphasized, you are that. Not a part of that, not belong to that. You are that. So, upakrama, upasamhara, abhyasa. Then, apurvata. What is unique? Unique meaning, this non-dual truth can be understood only by the proper study, reflection of the scriptures. The valid means of knowing the self is only Shabda Praman. It is not available for perception, not available for inference, not available for any other modes of valid means of knowledge. It is available for Shabda Praman. So the uniqueness of the Upanishads is the revelation of the essential oneness of Jiva and Brahma. That is the most unique aspect of Upanishads, which is not found anywhere else. So, apurvata is also there. Apurvata is Advaita, repetition is Advaita. In the beginning it is said is Advaita. What is said at the end also is Advaita. Then phalam, what is the result? Okay, if I study this Advaita, and okay, understandable. Suppose you are saying all this means tattvamasi, means that you are one with that Brahman. If I understand this, what will be the result? The result will be, you will discover you are Brahman, you become one with Brahman. So what is the phalam? Acharyavan purusho veda, tasya tavadeva chiram yavat na vimokshye atha sampatsye. So when you have a teacher, when you listen to it from this teacher, this knowledge, like Shvetaketu heard from his own father, Uddala Krishi, and he realized the truth. The person who listens to Brahma Vidya, if the mind is ready, will discover, I am not the Jiva. The root cause of all sorrow will be destroyed. Tarati Shokam Atmavit is another mantra from the same Upanishad. The person goes beyond all shoka and moha. You see, Naradji, he knew so many scriptures, yet he had grief. He went to Sanat Kumars, and Sanat Kumars gave him this knowledge and told him that till you don't know the self, you cannot go beyond grief. And the knower of the self goes beyond grief. Tarate shokam atmavit. So what will be the result? As long as I think I am this body, mind, intellect, one jiva, I will have attachments, aversions, I will be miserable. I have fear, I have insecurity, all kinds of problems. But when I realize the imperishable absolute truth that I am infinite consciousness, I am freed. The entire dream world ends when the waker wakes up. So, the result also is experience of one absolute truth. The knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. Sayoha vaitat paramam brahma veda brahmaiva bhavati. The Mundaka Upanishad is said very clearly. Whoever knows Brahman becomes Brahman. Is this not very great and unique? See, luckily, if I know physics, I don't become physics. I know law of gravity, I don't become gravity. If I know biology, I don't become a plant. Or botany, I don't become a plant. But this knowledge is not an objective knowledge. This is a knowledge of the self, Atma. And actually it is my true nature. I don't even become Brahman. I just realize that I am, I was, I will always be Brahman. I am eternal, timeless. So one becomes free. From lifetimes of sorrow, aneka janma samprapta karma bandha vidahine atma jnana pradanena tasmai shri gurave namah. Not knowing I am that infinite Brahman, I am going life after life, getting stuck in the cycle of karma. So here he says, that is the result. And Shvetaketu realized that. So that is a phala. Then what is the praise? What is glorified again and again? Not empty flattery. It is really something which is glorious. So what does the Upanishad say? Uta tam adesham aprakshyo yena ashrutam shrutam bhavati amatam matam avignatam vignatam. In fact, this is the question that Shvetaketu was asked by his father. You know, Shvetaketu, when he came after studying in the Gurukul, from the way he was coming, the father understood ki, oh, this boy doesn't know the truth. So he asked him this question, that did you ask for that truth, knowing which the invisible becomes visible, the unheard of becomes heard, and that which is not known becomes known, avignatam vignatam bhavati. And Shvetaketu answered with lot of arrogance, saying, if my teacher knew, he would have taught me. And the father gave it back, saying, did you ask for it? He said, no. And he gets humbled there. Then the father then teaches the Upadesh Tattvamasi through the 9 experiments. So what is glorified is this knowledge, that this is the knowledge by which the invisible becomes visible. Now, invisible becomes visible means not some secret of the universe is revealed. So what is invisible has become visible. The so-called invisible, which I was not aware of till now, becomes visible, that my nature is Atma. Today one is going around asking, you know, Vivekananda went around asking people, have you seen God? Have you seen God? Have you seen God? And everybody gave him some knowledge, some theories, and he said, I don't want theories. Have you seen God? Till he met Ramakrishna, who said, I have seen God and I see him more closely than I see you. What is the meaning of that sentence? See, in general, one says that, okay, he had darshan of Mother Kali and for him Kali was real, etc. But if you think from Vedanta standpoint, what is more real than the world is the experience of aham, I am. I am rises first. Rises meaning we become aware when we wake up. Otherwise, it is always there. Aham, 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 sphurana is always there. That aham is the experience of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, that I am that pure consciousness, Sachidananda Swarup Atma. In me, the world rises. In me, it stays. In me, it goes back. I am not born into the world. The world is born into me. Hence, he says, I have seen God and I see him more closely than I see you. Because that's an aparoksha anubhuti. That is a direct experience of the truth, of the self. Then comes the objective world. Like what Ramana Maharshi said, aham rises first, then idam rises. When we go into sleep, this small I, this aham is not there, then the idam also is not experienced. Who is behind this small I, this aham vritti, is the pure aham, pure consciousness, which is always there. That today I am not aware of. How funny is that? That is, which is my own nature, I don't know that. And because of that ignorance, I am suffering. So he says, have you asked that by knowing which the invisible becomes visible, the unheard becomes heard, the what is not known becomes known? So this is the knowledge of the self that is glorified also. And finally, demonstration. So demonstration is through lot of examples in the Tattva. In Chandogya, the demonstration happens. So he takes one lump of clay. And he says, if you understand this clay, then you will understand all the vessels made of clay everywhere in the world. Because that clay is the basic substance. Beautiful mantra is, Yatha saumya ekena mritpindena sarvam mrinmayam vignatam. Ekena mritpindena. With one lump of clay, if you understand, then you can understand all the cups and pots and pitcher, saucer, everything made from that mud. In the same way, vijnatam syat, vacharambhanam vikaro namadheyam mrittika iti eva satyam. This cup and pot and pitcher and saucer is only modification of speech. What is the truth? Truth is mud. this mud, you turn it in a certain way, it becomes a pot. You transform it in another way, it becomes a cup. You transform it some other way, it becomes a plate. All the three are plate and cup and pot are only words. What is the essence? Essence is, it is mud. Same way, what is the essence? This body is only one form. So many forms are there, like different cups, pots, pitchers, saucers are there. Same way, so many countless beings are there. What is the truth? But just like the mud is the truth there, Atma is the truth here. Different experiments he does and demonstrates. Daily life examples. He takes one glass of water and he tells Shvetaketu, add salt in this water. So he adds salt, he mixes it. Now he says, now you take the water from the top of the glass, taste it. How it is? He says, salty. Now take from the middle of the glass, how is it? Salty. Take from the bottom, how is it? It is salty. So then he says, just like this salt pervades this entire water everywhere, in that same way, Atma pervades this whole universe. And you are that Atma. At the end of every experiment, he says, Tattvamasi Shvetaketu. Tells him, take a banyan seed. He says, what do you see here? He says, a seed. He says, this whole huge banyan tree, how it is there in unmanifest form in this seed, in that way, in your heart is this absolute truth from where the whole universe comes, and you are that truth. So this is called Shravanam, where one applies these six factors to determine what is the essence. Now, obviously, now everywhere, all the six factors may not be applicable. In some places, demonstration may not be there. In some places, the repetition may not be there. But broadly, and these six factors came from where? They are in the Mimamsa Shastra. In Mimamsa, what they use, same thing we are using in Vedanta also here. So this shloka is from that. Upakrama upasamharav abhyaso apurvata phalam arthavada upapatticha lingam tatparya nirnaye. This is from the Mimamsa. So if we apply these six factors and we understand, okay, the essence of the Upanishad is, it is telling us, I am Atma, I am not this body, mind, intellect. Now, whoever has done the Shravanam carefully will instantly realize the truth if the mind is ready. Nothing more that person needs to know. Like the famous example in Vedanta is the 10th person. 10 fools, they cross the river and then they go on the other side. And now they are crying loudly. Every fellow is sitting and crying loudly, saying, what happened? Are the 10th man is drowned. And they all are grieving for the 10th man. One wise man comes there. He says, what happened to you? Why are you all crying? He says, we started 10 of us. And now when we crossed, only 9 of us are there. One person has died. He drowned on the way. So he makes them all stand in line. And he makes them count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And the 10th person, he says, you put your hand on your head. You put for 9 people. Now put on your head. You are the 10th person. Now who was the 10th person? Every fellow there was the 10th person actually. The moment the hand is put on his head, he realizes, sorry, I am the 10th person. The other person says, I am also the 10th person. Everybody realizes, I am the 10th person. The guru does that job. We are already that pure Brahman. But we are not recognizing that. Our mind is extroverted. So if the mind has been purified with karma yoga, unified with this upasana, then this transcendence of the false identification will happen. That is called chitta atikramanam. Chitta shuddhi, chitta ekagrata, chitta atikramanam. One goes beyond the jiva bhava. So if one is ready, instantly one will realize that. So this is the first sadhana. In jnana sadhana, the main sadhana is shravanam. Because please remember, everything else depends on the shravanam. How intensely do I do shravanam? How do I determine the essence? and I am at least clear ki this is the essence. Whether I am convinced by it or not is a secondary issue. First, I should be convinced ki the essence is Advaita Vedanta. That itself takes long time. Many people don't accept only. They will say, no, how can I and God be one? Arey, but who is that I? That I is not this jiva. The water in the wave and the water in the ocean is the same water. There is no difference. Wave may be small, ocean may be huge, but both are water only. Essentially, both are water. If you remove the upadhi of the wave, remove upadhi of Ishvara, I mean of the ocean, what remains? Only water, pure water, nothing else. So, Shravanam has to be done. Now, when we do this Shravanam, as it is said earlier, we have to listen to this from a realized person. So, it is not just Shravanam which is important, but Acharya Mukha Shravanam Kuryat. One should listen to it from a realized person. Oh, Swamiji, where will we find realized people? We develop the qualities, we develop intense longing for this knowledge, the right teacher will come into our life. We don't have to go hunting for a teacher. Develop that adhikara, the qualifications, Vivek, Vairagya, Shatka, Sampati, Mumukshutvam. As we do, our Gurudev Swami Chimayananji used to give the example of a flower. He said the flower's job is to open up. The moment the flower opens up, the fragrance will spread and the bee will come automatically to pollinate the flower. But if the flower says, till the bee doesn't come, I will not open up. What is the use of my opening up? No need. Then the bee may come, go around the flower and go away. The flower will remain as it is. It will just wither away. Our job is wherever we are, we do our duty dedicated to Bhagwan, do the Chitta Shuddhi, do the Upasana, and the Guru will come. Nisargat Maharaj is one example. Even Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is another example. They didn't go hunting for a guru. Guru themselves came at the right time. The right teacher came into their lives. At one point in time, there was a Brahmani who came into the life of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa to initiate him into Tantra Vidya and all that. At another point in time, Totapuri Maharaj came to initiate him into the formless Sachidananda Swarup, Brahman. He didn't go around asking, finding out which is the teacher, which is the teacher. So we have to only cultivate that qualification and then listen. Now, while listening, this Shadvidalinga, if we apply, we will determine, yes, the essence of this Upanishad or the essence of Bhagavad Gita. You can apply this Shadvidalinga to the Gita also. A beautiful exercise to do. And determine that you will come to this conclusion that finally it will be that Gita is talking about essential oneness of Jiva and Brahma. That is the crux of the Bhagavad Gita. Now, when we listen to this, there may be doubts. See, if the mind is very purified, instantly the realization will happen. No doubts, nothing. But if the mind is not yet ready for it, naturally doubts will be there. Now, why doubts will be there? Because it is exactly opposite to what I believe. We believe I am the body, Vedanta says you are not the body. We believe I am born, Vedanta says you are unborn. We believe we are going to die at point in time, Vedanta says you are eternal, immortal. We believe world is real, Vedanta says world is illusory. So it will contradict with our knowledge, existing knowledge. So naturally doubts will arise. How can I be one with God? How can I be infinite? How can the world not be real? I am experiencing it through my senses, my mind, my emotions. How is it not real? So the second sadhana is for clearing these doubts. So Shravanam helps us to remove this notion that I don't know the truth. By determining the essence, this first obstacle to knowledge, I don't know, goes. Mananam helps to remove, I can't understand. So what is exactly mananam? So now comes the definition of mananam. Mananam tu, so before I go into the definition, man means to reflect. Manute means to think, to reflect. And to reflect using logic, is called mananam. That if there is a statement which is made, then what is the reasoning behind that? This is a beautiful aspect of our culture. So it's not just because it's said in the Veda, I have to believe. This authoritarian aspect does not work in our culture. We accept with Shraddha if the Guru says or if the Shastra says, but that Shraddha is not a blind Shraddha. There's nothing called blind Shraddha actually. Blind belief may be there. There cannot be blind faith. Faith is belief reinforced with conviction. Then only it becomes faith. From non-belief to belief and belief to faith and faith to knowledge. That's our journey. Shraddhavan labhate jnanam, it is said. But that Shraddha is not just because it is said we have to believe. No, no. That's why this mananam step is important. Using logic and the experience of other great masters, we have to convince ourselves by removing all our doubts. So reflection is a very important step. Reflection leads to intellectual conviction. Clarity and conviction come through reflection. Determining of essence is through listening and shravanam. Mananam will bring the intellectual clarity and conviction. How? Using scriptural logic and experience. That's why in Sadhana Panchakam, Shankaracharya ji says, Vakyarthascha Vicharyatam. You reflect upon the meaning of the Mahavakya after listening from the teacher. Shruti Shiro Vakyam Samakarnyatam. Listen to Vedanta from this teacher. Then Vakyarthascha Vicharyatam. Study, reflect on the meaning of the Mahavakya. How? Vakyarthascha Vicharyatam. Shruti Shira Paksha Samashriyatam. And use the logic given in the scriptures. Don't use any logic. The logic is very weird. One can prove something with logic. One can disprove also with logic. But it has no, it is not necessarily valid. Simplest form of logic all of us understand is what? A loves B, B loves C, so A loves C. How is it possible? Really, it may not be applicable. Now, the daughter loves the father, father loves the student, so the daughter loves the student. What logic? Logically, it is fitting, but it is not real, it is not true. One can use logic for anything. And there is enough logic, so-called logic, which is used to prove the Mahavakya has some other meaning. But what does Advaita Vedanta say? So he says, Shruti Shira Vakyam Samakarnyatam. Vakyarthascha Vicharyatam, Shruti Shira Paksha Samashriyatam. Take the logic given in Vedanta. Don't use some logic. And very clearly he gives a warning. He says, do not use fallacious logic. Dustarka Suviramyatam, Shruti Matas Tarkonu Sandhiyatam. You do reflection based on the scriptural logic. And scripture has given proper logic. Why I am not the Atma? Drigdrishya Vivek is one. The seer and seen, that logic is given. Panchakosha Vivek is one. Avasthatraya Sakshi is one. You know, a lot of reasonings are given. Using that, one should determine, oh, I am not this, I am this. Not just some random logic. In today's world, that too is very common. We don't study our scriptures. Some vested interest people, they have to propagate some logic, which is, there's no logic only. There's no consistency, there's no logic. They want to highlight something which they want to glorify, and they want to condemn something which they feel is, bad. Then they go on doing anything. So what is the logic behind it? Kanyadan, Kanyaman. And no need of Kanyadan, we will do Kanyaman. What nonsense is that? They don't even know what is Kanyadan, what is the meaning of Kanyadan, and put any logic just because one is wanting to, you know, further a certain agenda. That is stupid. Kanya is not an object that is given in Dan. That's not our bhav. Anyway, that's a different topic altogether. But my point is that logic has to be utilized properly based on the scriptural tradition. If that is not satisfying, then think about it. But if you go by the scriptural tradition, proper logic is given. So he said, Dustarkar Suviramyatam, you go away from this fallacious logic, which appears so-called logical, but it is useless. You know, sometimes people apply this logic. Anyway, world is illusory, so how does it matter? What is right and what is wrong? Why should I bother about? Eat, drink, and be merry. Because anyway, it is all illusory. That is called Dustarka. The reason why one is saying the logic, the world is illusory, is because it is continuously changing. You are the drashta who is changeless. So withdraw from the changing to abide in the changeless. The logic is that. But one has not understood. So one is saying, oh, because it is illusory, there's nothing right and wrong. I can do anything and I can get away with it. And there's no greater purpose. Just eat, drink, and be merry. What absolutely false logic. So mananam is to use scriptural logic. And so the definition of mananam is this, that my reflection is based on scriptural logic. So the definition is mananam tu shrutasya advitiya vastunaha vedanta anuguna yuktibihi anavaratam anuchintanam. Vedanta anuguna. As per Vedantic logic, yukti bihi, yukti is logic. Cause and effect relationship is called logic. Using the Vedantic logic, when I reflect continuously that how I am Brahman, I am not this body, mind, intellect, anavaratam, unbroken, anuchintanam, continuous reflection, that is called mananam. And that mananam will lead me to clarity and conviction that yes, how I am Brahman. So different aspects we have to use here. Suppose we say, let us take a simple example. Vedanta says world is, there is no happiness in the world. That is called pratignya, the statement of Vedanta. What is the hetu? What is the logic? The logic is if happiness was in the world, everybody experiencing the objects in the world would have experienced happiness. Suppose you take one example, the sugar. Now, the nature of that sugar is sweetness. So, everybody eating sugar will experience that sweetness. The nature of fire is heat and light. Now, everybody coming in contact with fire will feel the light, and if they touch it, they will feel hot. Because that's the nature of the fire. Now, is that applicable to the world in terms of happiness? Is everybody contacting the world and experiencing happiness? That we are not seeing. If the nature of the world was happiness, everybody experiencing the world must be happy. But that we are not seeing. Even when a situation is there for being happy, two people experiencing the same situation are not happy. You know, a person, simple example again, a student gets 50% marks, is very happy. And the other student has got 96% marks, but is miserable. Why? Because he didn't get 98, which is the topper mark. And this fellow, he did not even aspire to pass, but he's got 50%, he passed. He is very happy. So if happiness was out there in those marks, then everybody who is getting the marks should have been happy. And one who has got the maximum mark should have been more happy than this person. But it is not out there. So that is called logic. And not only the other people, same person at different times contacting the same object will have different experience. First rasgulla I eat, I feel very happy. 10th rasgulla I eat, it is pain. So, same object it is. Or in a relationship, there's a honeymoon period, everybody is very happy with each other. Then after that, you know, one says, I can't live without you, one was saying earlier. Now one is saying, I can't live with you. The person is the same. So, logic is that if it happiness was in that person, then everybody contacting that person should have felt happy and inspired. But that is not happening. And the experiential proof is also this. So, pratignya hetu drishtant. What is the statement? What is the logic? And what is the experiential proof? If something is confirmed by logic and experiential proof, then it has to be accepted as true. Now, if you apply this to Atma, why it is said I am not the Atma? The logic is the seer and the seen are different. I am not the body, mind, intellect, because I can see the body, mind, intellect very clearly. And seer is not one with the seen. Seer and seen are different. That is one logic. Are there people who have experienced it? Yes, there are so many great realized masters who have experienced this truth. Their body has been in such terrible condition, but they are reveling in absolute bliss. No fear, reveling in absolute bliss, not identified with the body. Ramana Maharshi, he had sarcoma and the doctor wanted to give him anesthesia to operate on him. He said, I already gone beyond body identification, do without any anesthesia. And they did. The operation was done without anesthesia. He didn't bother at all. He said, I've already gone beyond. So many examples. Ramakrishna had throat cancer. People told him that, why don't you ask Mother Kali to cure your throat cancer? And Ramakrishna said, I don't ask Mother for these petty things. So examples are there. I'm not even giving Puranic examples or aitihasic examples. These are examples of saints in the last century. So many great Mahatmas this country has produced like that, who have shown to us what is the power of this Advaita Vedanta, that how we are not the body, mind, intellect, we are that pure consciousness. So now that is pratigna, that you are not the body, mind, intellect, you are Atma. What is the logic? Seer is different from the seen. What is the experiential proof? So many great Mahatmas have experienced. I have also experienced, each of us have experienced in some way or the other. When we are in deep sleep, we are not aware of the body, mind, intellect, and we are most blissful. Why? Because neither the body is we are aware of, nor the Jiva Bhav we are aware of. We are closest to Brahman. Just the veil of ignorance is there, avidya is there, that's all. So the deep sleep experience also is there, that without the BMI also I still am, and I am of the nature of bliss. So using reflection, using this kind of scriptural logic, and there are specific books which are there for these things. You see, the beauty of our culture is this. There are specific books for Shravanam. There are specific books for Mananam. Books like Advaita Makaranda are there, which are Mananatmak Granthas. There are specific books for Nididhyasana. You know, Brahma Jnanavali is there, Nirvana Shatkam is there, Upanishad Mantras are there. All that are meant for Nididhyasana. So for reflection, there are specific books. Contemplation, there are specific books. For just the listening, there are specific books. Then to cultivate Vivek Vairagya Shatka Sampati Mukshutam, also there are specific books. Bhaja Govindam, Vairagya Shatakam, you know, beautiful books are there. For every stage, there are different books. To develop bhakti, the whole Puranic literature is there, itihasas are there, amazing knowledge our culture has. So these are first two steps. Shravanam helps to remove the ignorance of the truth that I don't know. Mananam helps to remove I can't understand. And please remember, Mananam will happen properly only based on Shravanam. If Shravanam is not done properly, Mananam cannot happen. So for today, I will stop here. And if there are any questions, we have 10 minutes. You are welcome to ask.
Thank you very much, Swamiji. That was a very fascinating, very insightful account. Viewers, as Swamiji said, if you have any questions, now is the time to type it out. If you type it on Q&A box, I'll submit it to Swamiji. Swamiji, you made an important comment just a while back about how different texts of Vedanta, especially the Prakarana Granthas, are aimed at towards different purpose. And I think this is a point most of us, especially those who are just starting out, do not realize. You mentioned how Brahma Gyana Valimala is focused on Nididhyasam, whereas text like Tattva Bodha is more for Shravanam, to understand the basics of philosophy. So I think I found this comment to be a very strong perspective, very kind of game changer perspective, so to speak. Because I Brahma Gyana Valimala is one of my favorite texts, and how the Shankaracharya says asangoham 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 punapuna. But if a new beginner reads it, I don't think he will be able to actually appreciate it. Right. But there is a chance that he may be misguided to misinterpret more because of the lack of understanding of basic Vedantic knowledge. So can you shed more light on this? What are the texts that that are aimed at Shravanam, and what are the texts for Mananam, for Yukti Mananam, and what are the texts for Nididhyasam?
So we should apply the Siddhant. See, the principle is Shravanam, as we said, is to determine the essence. Now, books like you said, Tattva Bodh, Atma Bodh, Upadeshar, Sadhana Panchakam, so many of these books are there, which will give the fundamentals very clearly, as well as the essence also. And by themselves, they are enough to lead a seeker to realization also, if the mind is ready. Now, if the student has not studied those books properly, and one goes to the higher books, like today, a lot of people study the Gita without understanding Tattva Bodh or even Bhajagovindam, one straight away wants to study the Gita, then what will happen is after some point, one will get confused or one will not derive the proper meaning, the depth of the meaning. So one should listen to some of these books first, which are the Shravanatma Granthas or the Prakarana Granthas. So Tattva Bodh, Atma Bodh, Bhajagovindam, all these are Shravanatma. To a certain extent, Vivek Chudamani is a Mananatmaka Grantha, because the Yukti is given very clearly of the Panchakosha, and the negation of the Panchakosha also happens very, very clearly. And then, of course, Nididhyasan, Jivan Mukti Lakshan, all that is also there in that. But there's a lot of reflection there in Vivek Chudamani. So Vivek Chudamani can be used for Mananam. Advaita Makarandam can be used for Mananam. Some of the Upanishads also one can use for Mananam, because Upanishad also follows the Siddhant of the highest knowledge is given first. If that is not understood, then it is elaborated for the Madhyam Adhikari. If that is not understood, then for the Adham Adhikari, it will give the Upasanas, etc. So some of the Upanishads also one can use for Mananam. Like for example, Taittiriya Upanishad one can use, because if one understands Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma, that is very easy. Shravanam done, then the job is done. But then the same thing is elaborated in that whole second chapter of Taittiriya Upanishad. It is that one line, Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma, Yoveda Nihitam Guhayam Paramev Yoman, So Oshnute Sarvan Kaman Saha. That whole second chapter is elaboration only of this much line, this much part of the mantra. So one can use that chapter to do more reflection. And then comes the Nididhyasanatma Grantha. What happens to most of us is, that is where we use the Nididhyasanatma Grantha for Mananam. Like you said, asangoham, 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 punah punah. I don't have to use any logic at that point in time. This has to be used in contemplation. There I am starting to use how I am asanga, how I am detached, how I am not the body, how I am Brahman. Why? That reflection is not required there. Nididhyasana only is required. Even this Nirvana Shatkam, Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. Three lines of negation, one line of assertion. So tomorrow when we speak about Nididhyasana, I will elaborate more also on that. That these books which are meant for Nididhyasan should be actually used for Nididhyasan by us, having done our Shravanam and Mananam through other books very carefully, so that we derive the maximum result. Nothing wrong by itself if you use logic for Nididhyasanatma Grantha, but the full benefit does not come.
I think it could lead to some kind of misinterpretation also.
Yeah.
To believe that just thinking asangoham, yeah, just to think them shivoham is enough. You don't need to do any rituals, you don't need to do any chitta shuddhi, any upasana. I think that is why the proper foundation of Shravana Granthas is necessary for before doing the Vidyasana. We have received one question, Swamiji. I think we have just four more minutes, so I'll just read out the question. What is the problem with applying non-Vedantic logic for Mananam? I think Ashruti Tarka, that is the question. Yeah.
See, the problem happens is, one is that the logic which is given in Vedant Shastra is a logic which is to help us to negate who I am not very clearly and assert who I am very clearly. So when it says Dridrishya Vivek, that seer and seen are different, or Panchakosha Vivek, that why is it that I am not the five layers of the personality? Now I should know what is five layers for that. If I use a non-Vedantic logic, chances are the comprehensiveness will not be there. I may negate one part of the false identification, but I may not negate other parts. That is possibility. Also, possibility is that sometimes that logic itself may be fallacious. Like many people use this logic, you know. In context of God, let us say. So they will say, if God really existed, then there would be no suffering in the world. Now, there is no logic behind that reasoning actually. Because God is not responsible for suffering in the world. Jiva's Purushartha is responsible for the karma phala, and then Punya Papa is the result of that karma. Now, God is only the presiding force. The Purushartha Kshamata is in the human being. Now, this logic is based on the scriptural understanding. If I study scripture properly, I will understand very clearly. If I have not studied the scripture and Vedanta properly, then my whole Shraddha in God itself gets shaken up, which was actually not a proper Shraddha. It was some blind belief I had earlier. Otherwise, it would not shake up. So, same thing in the question, in the case of Atma. Like simple another challenge, if I say, now if you negate the five koshas, what will remain at the end? If you don't come to Vedanta, the logic will say it is shunyavada, it is nothingness, it is blank, it is emptiness. And is it not that today majority of the people practicing meditation are, what is the goal they are striving for? I want to become blank, I want to become thoughtless. What will you do becoming thoughtless? Nothing will happen becoming thoughtless. Honestly, every night deep sleep we are becoming thoughtless, nothing is happening. If you want to become thoughtless in 1 second, I can make you thoughtless. One fart loudly I give you, no? One chamat, for a second you will be thoughtless. What happened? Nothing will happen with that. Vedanta will tell us, if you transcend this body, mind, intellect, how your nature is that Satchidananda Swarupatma. See, what did Nachiketa ask Bhagavan Yama? He said, anyatra dharmat, anyatra adharmat, anyatra asmat, kritat, kritat, anyatra bhutacha bhavyacha, yat tat pasyasi tadvada. You tell me what you are experiencing. His question was not that is there life after death. His question was, what is the nature of the truth when I transcend the BMI? Is it existence or non-existence? Asti iti cha eke, na ayam asti iti cha eke. Some people are saying it is non-existence. So this aspect of shunyavad, non-existence, or some higher loka, go and stay in that world, that is a concept of moksha, all those things will come into picture if I use a non-Vedantic logic for mananam. And based on my mananam, it will be my nididhyasanam. So if I am convinced that I am this atma, then nididhyasana will lead me to realization of the self. If I am convinced that ultimate is blank, you see, Upanishad is very clear. It is said, asanneva sabhavati asad brahmeti veda chet. If somebody says Brahman is non-existent, that person will become non-existent. So you will reach that destination, Baba. प्रकृति लय मोक्ष इट विल बी और इट विल बी जड़वाद जड़ समाधि. So the reasoning why we have to follow the Vedantic logic is to understand very clearly why the ultimate is the Atma and how that Atma is I. It is not a blank. It is not something to be attained afterwards. It is not after death. It is not, in some loka. All those false notions have to get cleared. So that is why the Vedantic logic has to be used.
Thank you, Swamiji. That was a very detailed and to the point answer. I hope the person asking the question, his doubts are clarified. So viewers, we will continue this discussion. Tomorrow also is the second part of this Weekend with Wisdom. Same time, 5 to 6:30 p.m. Do join. And Swamiji will be here. And if you have any questions from today, do reflect over it. Tomorrow, Swamiji will answer them. Swamiji, thank you again for taking time to do this session. And we look forward to tomorrow's session. Viewers, do follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Join our Facebook discussion group as well for more updates. With this, we conclude the session. Shri Gurubhyo Namah.
Thank you, Hari Om. Om Purnamada. पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते. ओम शांति शांति शांति. हरिः ओम. श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः. हरिः ओम. थैंक यू
स्वामीजी.